morning. Thank you to those here in person and to those who are just now joining us online. If you guys would like to stand up, we're going to worship our Lord this morning.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. 'Cause failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. Failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does.
Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Arrival's not the end game, the journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over, the story isn't good. 'Cause failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Failure's never final when the Father's in the room.
Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Prodigals come home, the helpless find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room.
Jericho walls are quaking, strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. And love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
And these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole.
forsaken, I've been set free. I've been set free. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, see it now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to our failure, you take our weakness, you set your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. See the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. Can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to devoted, like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes, for you will have your bride free of all her guilt and rid of all her shame and known by her true name. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints we sing worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints we sing worthy are you, Lord. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips.
Going to use this time now to open up the altars, give you guys an opportunity just to come and share with your Lord today what's on your heart. Maybe you have some burdens that you've been carrying. Maybe you just want to praise God for how he's working in your life. Maybe there's somebody who's on your heart and you just want to lift them up in prayer. Whatever the case may be, the altars are open. And if God is leading you, we'd invite you to come as you are. Give your burdens, your petitions, your praises to the Lord this morning.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinners, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame, and all who are broken, lift up your face, O wanderer.
So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are.
There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, and rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure.
So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame, and all who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurts, lay down your heart, come as you are.
Sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame, and all who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurts and lay down your heart. Come as you are.
Come as
we come before you with our heads bowed and our hearts humbled. Heavenly Father, that we know that you are the God, you are the King of Kings, you are the only God. There is no other like you, Lord. Heavenly Father, you created the universe. Heavenly Father, we know that you hold in your hands the whole world. Heavenly Father, we know that you know our, that you are all-knowing God. You know our standing. You know our laying down. You know our thoughts, Lord, from afar off. God, you are a healer. We know that you are, Lord. And Lord, we thank you for that, Lord. Heavenly Father, we also know that you are an all-knowing God. We also know, Heavenly Father, that you are an all-powerful God. Heavenly Father, you created the mountains with your hand. You also, Heavenly Father, you carved out the valleys. Heavenly Father, you created this body, and it ticks just like you want it to tick, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, I also know that you are a timeless spirit, Heavenly Father. And I also know that you are perfect, and you love us who are imperfect. And Lord, we also know that our bodies are timed, that someday these bodies will just go back to dust the way that they came, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we also know in your perfection, Lord, in your majesty, and how great you are, Lord, that not one of us have the same fingerprints. When we turn around, Heavenly Father, and we look at the earth and we see the beauty of it, Lord, we also know that every snowflake is unique, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we know that we have sunshine. Heavenly Father, we know that sometimes it's raining. But it's all powered by you, because you know exactly what we need when we need it. Even in our complaints, God, you are perfect. Heavenly Father, and I just thank you, Lord, that there's so much going on in the world, but Lord, you're so much bigger than any trial or tribulation that we may have. Heavenly Father, you're so much bigger than any disease that may be running rampant in our bodies. Heavenly Father, you're so much bigger, Lord, than depression. You're so much bigger, Lord, than schizophrenia. All we have to do, Lord, is rest in you, and you will give us comfort, Lord. You said that you will give comfort to the weary. And we know that you will, Lord. Heavenly Father, we also know that you're there in our financial depression. When our banks feel like our bank account may seem bankrupt, Lord, but you're right there. You can even multiply that. You can put it in the positive. You can even multiply it. And we know that because you fed the 5,000 men and many more with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. So you are God that will multiply. You are God that will increase our needs, Heavenly Father. So we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. Lord, we thank you that we're in the house of the Lord today. We're thankful that we can praise you today, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. And Heavenly Father, I would like to pray for our pastor, Pastor Amy, as she come forth and bring the word, and that her word will be able to restore our spirits back to you, Lord. Heavenly Father, and also I'm asking that she will be able to decrease and allow the Holy Spirit to increase in her as she bring forth not just the word, but the living word. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you sent your son Jesus, Lord. He is our hope in a hopeless place. He is our help in a time when we feel like there's no help. Heavenly Father, we just thank you that Jesus came to earth and that he went to Calvary. And Heavenly Father, we're so glad that not only did he go to the cross, but what we do know is that he went to the grave. But then the story doesn't end there, Lord. He got out of the grave. And Lord, right now, he's on the right-hand side of the Father. And he's interceding for us, Lord. So, Lord, that gives us hope, Lord. That gives us hope, Lord. And we thank you. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you, Lord. I bring before you, Heavenly Father, we have had a great loss right here at Flint First. Pastor Frank was an amazing man. I lift up his wife. I lift up his children, his grandchildren, Lord. We lift up his friends. We lift up his family right here at Flint First, Lord. What an amazing person, Lord. But what you said in your word is that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And what did Paul say? Paul said, to live is Christ and to die is gain. Yes, Heavenly Father, we don't like it when you come in and interrupt our lives from the people that we love, but we do understand that you are perfect in all that you do. And we also understand that there is an eternity that is set before us. So we praise you, Lord. We praise you for having an eternity waiting for not just Pastor Frank, but also for all of us, that we can enter in and we can sup at the table with you, Lord. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing, Lord. And Lord, give them strength as they go through this process here on earth. Because right now we already know that the dinner table is empty. And there are broken people. They're hurting, Lord. But what I do know, Lord, is that you can wipe every tear away. And I also know that there will be some joy. Oh, Heavenly Father, do I know about joy coming? Not when we want it, but you said in your word that it's going to come in the morning. So we're going to rest on that, Heavenly Father. There will be joy. So we thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the name of your precious Son, Jesus, amen.
So lay down your burden.
I just wanted to sit in that, didn't you? Oh, it was beautiful. The Holy Spirit is definitely here. It's palpable. You can feel it. It's amazing. I get the absolute joy and privilege to introduce to you today. We have some special guests in our service today. If you can go ahead and put their slide up, please. Thank you, Andrea. So we are going to be welcoming, well, it says welcome Trey and Michaela. Trey actually had to work. He is a nurse at Beaumont. And so, unfortunately, those of us who are in the medical field, we understand that's a 24/7 operation. So sometimes when things get planned, other things come in, and that happens sometimes. So Trey is not here, but his beautiful wife, Michaela, is. And they are working with Global Partners. And they are... They're in community development down in Dearborn. And so she is going to share some of the things that they've been doing down in Dearborn. And I wanted to put this slide up here because if you want to make a check, make it payable to Global Partners and just put the fund number there for them. Because after she's done, we are going to take a love offering for them. We want to encourage them in their endeavors and what they are doing. So at this time, I would like to welcome Michaela.
Good morning, Flint First. Oh, is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. Hi, everybody. It is such a privilege to be here with you this morning. I just got to say, you guys have been so incredibly welcoming, super, super grateful. As Pastor Amy said, obviously my husband Trey couldn't be here today. He was really bummed. But I do have with me my 5-month-old daughter, Louisa, and her grandma here to help out this morning. And I have to say, the amount of people who saw me walk in with a baby and offered to show me where the changing table was awesome. Don't change. Like, that was so, so kind. So thank you guys so much for helping us feel welcome and inviting us here this morning. We're really excited just to be able to share a little bit of our hearts for our community. The name of our field is called WAHA, and I'll explain a little bit more about what that means. But we're just really grateful just to have a few moments of your time this morning to share why we're living where we live and who we're serving and what the Lord has called us to. So the word WAHA means oasis in both Arabic and in Dari, which are the two main languages of the people groups that we work with. Besides English, in our community. And we really do believe that that word oasis is really indicative of the work that we do. We desire to be a safe place for those in our community, to welcome people into our community, and to be a support for those in our community. So that is why our field name is called WAHA. And we've been serving the WAHA field for 4 years now through Global Partners. And Global Partners provides global focus for the Wesleyan Church. So we're able to do that in the community that has the largest population of Arabs outside of the Middle East, which is just over an hour away from here, which is kind of crazy. And the work that our team does is twofold. On one hand, we do work to disciple and build relationships with the people in our community. We desire to see a flourishing group of Arab Christian fellowships growing in our community and thriving in that place. And then we also work to build relationships with our community members and the North American church to help bridge some of those gaps and build bridges within our community. We love what we get to do. We love the people that we get to serve, and we're so, so grateful to be a part of that work. And our hearts as a team, we really desire for our community to recognize that their value and their worth is not found in the good deeds that they do or the good works that they have accomplished in their life, but that their identity is found in who they are in Jesus Christ, which is all of our hopes, right? That we find our identity in who Christ says we are. So a few years ago, one of the platforms I serve in is teaching English to English language learners. A lot of people come to our community and don't speak English as a first language, so that's a great way to jump into the community and connect. And so we were in class, and we did this random activity I came up with of unscrambling sentences and working on some grammar. And the random sentence we had was, "I am not an engineer." And this was a group of all Middle Eastern women. And so I said, "Okay, if you're not an engineer, ladies, what could you be?" And immediately one of our students raised her hand. She said, "Oh, I'm nothing." And I said, "No, no, no, you're not nothing just because you don't have a job. And you're so much more than the things that you do." And this led us to a conversation about identity, which was a new word for these women. And I said, "Okay, I'm going to ask the question again. Who are you? Who are you on the inside? Not what you do. Who are you?" And many of the women said, "I'm a mother. I take care of my kids. I cook. I clean. I take care of the house." I said, "Those are amazing, incredible, important things. But I'm asking, who are you on the inside? Who does God say that you are? The Bible says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. So I want to ask you the question again, who are you?" And one of the older women from Yemen, she raised her hand and she said, "I am tough." I said, "What makes you tough?" She said, "I've been through a lot of really, really hard things in my life, and I have made it through. That makes me tough." Another woman raised her hand. She was from Afghanistan, and she said, "I am strong, and I am a model," and kind of flipped her hair. I said, "Absolutely." And then another woman, she raised her hand, and she said, I really want to make people feel safe when they're around me." I said, you're a safe place." And she said, "Yes, that's who I am." And all the women cheered together and in unison shouted, "I am woman." And it was this beautiful moment of recognition of who God truly says that they are. Now, I want you to imagine living every single day not knowing where your true identity lies. Our desire is that God would not only speak into our lives, our identities, but into the identities of those in our community. And we know that those deeper conversations don't just come out of thin air, that they come from developing deep and intentional relationships. And many times that begins by bridging those gaps despite our differences. So my husband, Trey, he was working in our backyard. We bought a house about 2 years ago in our community. Our whole neighborhood is families from Yemen, so the majority do not speak English. So we've just been trying to build relationships and connect there. And one of the cool ways we've surprisingly been able to connect is through our little puppy named Chad. He's a little golden doodle dog. We have a prayer card on the table. He's in it. He's awesome. We love him. But the kids in our neighborhood are obsessed with him. And so there's this boy, his name is Ali. He would come over to our house often and just come to play with Chad and hang out with Trey. And one day, Trey was doing work in the yard, and he came over and played with Chad for a while. And then all of a sudden, ran up to Trey, and he said, "Trey, are you a Christian or a Jew?" And Trey said, "Oh, I'm a Christian." He said, "What religion are you?" He said, "Oh, well, I'm a Muslim. I just went to Arabic school," and went on and on and on about all the things he had learned about the Quran and the Arabic language, and shared, because at Arabic school, that's what he was taught. So in the midst of their conversation, Trey was sharing what it looked like to be a follower of Jesus and some of those things that are similar and different. And then Ali started to share what end times were going to look like according to the Quran and the scales of right and wrong. And Trey shared, he was able to share, you know, we don't have to have those scales because of who Jesus Christ is in our lives. We don't have to worry about those things because Christ paid it all, and all of that is forgiven. And Ali kind of stood there for a moment and took that in, and then went on and on to talk about what he had learned. And after a few moments, he stopped abruptly and said, "Hey, Trey, do you want to go play soccer?" Trey was like, "Man, it's been over an hour. I really got to get inside. But let's get together tomorrow. Let's hang out. It was really good talking to you." And he patted him on the back and started walking him out. And Ali turned to him and he said, "I love that we can still be friends even though I'm a Muslim and you're a Christian." And he said, "Yes, buddy. It's so great. Come back tomorrow." And Ali continued to come back and has over the last several months to connect with Trey and Chad. And it's been really special. And Trey shares that that was such a meaningful conversation to have. He'd been having some personal stuff going on, just some tough weeks, and was so, so thankful that God was in the midst of that conversation, filling in the gap and leading and deepening relationship despite those barriers that may come. So as a team, we really do desire that all those in our community would come and understand a loving faith of Jesus Christ, that they would know who he is in their life. And there's a few ways that we do that. So as a team, we really desire to make ourselves known as Christ followers. We're very open that we are followers of Jesus. We share truth boldly. We sow seeds broadly, and we keep showing up. And that's a really high value in our team. We are people of prayer. We know that none of this work is possible because of our power or our strength. It is all the Holy Spirit leading and guiding, and us just being vessels and trying our best to be as obedient as possible. And then we also do utilize practical platforms for sharing and ministering in our community. So for two of our teammates, my husband included, they work in the hospital. They work there as professionals, but also work to build relationships with those that they're serving their patients with. We also, like I said, teach English, GED classes, citizenship classes. We assist in refugee resettlement, and really just try and practically bless our community in any way that we can. And that's a big desire and hope for us, that we can just be a blessing and show Christ's love through those things. And we also welcome groups to come and visit. So you guys aren't super far away. We would love to have a group of you come just to experience the community if you haven't been there before, try some really amazing food, meet some incredible people, and just get a taste of what life looks like on our field. So we, again, just want to thank you. I know Trey is so grateful that we were able to be here this morning. Thank you for your kindness, for being so welcoming, for really displaying Christ's love to us this morning, and giving us a few moments of your time just to share our hearts for our community. We have a little table in the back that has our prayer cards here. If you feel the Lord is pressing it on your heart to pray for us, we would deeply, deeply appreciate that. Your prayer is so coveted. We also have a newsletter that goes out every 3 months. If you'd be interested in receiving some of those updates, we'd love to get you signed up for that as well. So thank you guys so much. It's such a blessing to be here. And yeah, we just really appreciate you all. Thank you.
Good morning, Flint First. At this time, our ushers can come forward to do this love offering for Michaela and Trey and their mission. To continue on with our announcements for this morning, we just want to say welcome to those of you that are here in person and online. If you are new, we would love to connect with you, so go ahead and scan that QR code, stop by the welcome desk, or use that link online and fill out that connection card or form online. That is also our way of giving. If you have, if you are wanting to give digitally using your credit or debit card, go ahead and use those same methods, or there is a wood box at the welcome desk on your way out. To go ahead and continue, this Wednesday we are having a worship and prayer night for our Wednesday night summer programming. So at 6 o'clock, we will be having our dinner and then our time of worship and prayer at 6:30. This will be outside, weather permitting, so come prepared. And then in preparation for our block party on August 16th at Davison Roadside Park, we want to let you know of two things. If you are willing to help before, during, or after, please see Heather Jones before you leave today, just so she has an idea. And then also following service on August 6th and August 13th, we will be going out to neighborhood to canvass the neighborhood and invite them out to our block party. So be sure that you guys stick around on both or either one of those dates. And also on August 13th following service, Heather will be having a meeting following the service with anybody who is willing to volunteer for that block party on the 16th. And then as a reminder, ladies, we are having a women's retreat here Saturday, August 26th. This will be an all-day event, and the fee is $30 to help cover the cost. Lunch will be provided, and the theme of this event is Let It Go So You Can Grow. Also, church, we will be offering scholarships to those in our community that are wanting to come to this event but can't afford that full $30. So if you are interested in helping provide some of those scholarships, please see me following the service so we can get that all sorted out. And lastly, our beach day had to get postponed due to weather. So our beach day will be this Friday, August 4th from 4 to 7. This will be a potluck with hot dogs provided by the church. This is at Buttercup Beach. So if you have any questions, please see Heather Jones again for that. And just a reminder, today is Fifth Sunday, so that means that our kids and our children's volunteers will be upstairs, but Pastor Amy wants to help the kids be occupied during the service today. So if you kiddos can come on up and see Pastor Amy as she gets started, that would be great.
If you are normally somebody who goes downstairs at this time, come on up. I have Is that bad? Oh, now I'm on. I'm so sorry. Okay, I wasn't on before. We have, I don't know what you guys have been learning downstairs. Just a second. But upstairs, we have been learning about masks. Do you guys ever dress up? Do you ever dress up? Do you ever put a mask on? Yeah? Well, have you ever, has your parents ever cried and then you've said, like, Mom, what's wrong? And she said, oh, nothing, I'm okay. Have they ever done that? Yeah. See, sometimes us adults, we like to wear masks and we like to pretend that everything is okay. And so today, we're going to continue our series on masks. And so I have for you some masks that you can choose. You get one, okay, just one, because I don't know how many everybody can have. So just one for now. So you pick a mask, and we have some colored pencils here. Choose your favorite colored pencils. You can take two or three, and you can color those, and then we can wear our masks together, okay?
You don't know how to wear a mask?
Yeah, we're going to actually... We're learning to take off our masks and not to say that, oh, everything's okay when it's not. Because Jesus knows, doesn't he? He knows our thoughts and he knows what we're thinking anyways. So why can't we just be honest about it? Yeah, so pick one. Just pick one. Pick one. Pastor Chad's going to help. All right, so we are in week four of our series on masks. And we've been digging into the book of Ephesians. And today we're going to be in chapter 4. So if you want to flip to Ephesians chapter 4, that's what we're gonna be today. And I just want to say, parents, I had three kids. I know sometimes these days can be hairy. But we also know that we're a part of a family, and we really seriously welcome all of the kids. We're really glad that they're in service with us, and as they're learning to sit in service, there may be some outbursts, there may be some tears, there may be something, whatever, and that is really seriously okay. Again, we're glad they're here, and as they're learning, they're going to learn those things, and that is okay. God gives us grace for when we mess up, right, we're going to give grace for the little children as well. So again, we're in Ephesians, and over the past 3 weeks, we kind of talked about how we discovered that God knew who would use their free will to accept his free gift. And so as such, we've talked about that believers are chosen. If you go to that next slide, there we go. Believers are chosen before the foundation of the world. And believers, we have redemption through Jesus' blood and the forgiveness of sins. Believers are God's masterpiece, created to do good works, which God prepared in advance. Believers have been sealed with the Holy Spirit. And believers can do God's work through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so as we come to grips and like I talked about, and take off our masks, we must grasp the idea that we're going to be seen. And this is challenging. But it also can be refreshing. Sometimes we're going to struggle with things, and people may see us struggle with those things, just like I talked about. The children may struggle today in service, and that's okay. And as people see us struggle, we have to remember, like Michaela talked about, who we are and whose we are. And it's okay to take off our mask and be seen. So again, we're going to be in Ephesians 4, and so we're going to start right at verse 1. So therefore I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling, for you have been called by God. And again, this is our fourth chapter of Ephesians, and it seems like in every chapter, Paul keeps reiterating the fact that he's a prisoner. He's a prisoner for the Lord. He keeps saying, I, Paul, I'm in prison, but yet it's good. Right, I don't know for sure this is why, but I think Paul keeps reminding us that he's a prisoner because I think he wants us to know that it's worth it. It's worth it. Being a Christian, being a Christ follower, it may not always be an easy path to follow, but it's definitely worth it. And so many times maybe you hear this prosperity gospel, that everything's going to be great. Everything's going to be fine. If once you accept the Lord, it's going to be absolutely amazing. I'm sorry, that's not what the Bible says. He says, in this life, you will have trials. But going to leave you. I'm not going to forsake you. Right? And so I think that this is what Paul is trying to get at in this point, that it may be tough, but it's so worth it. And so he's basically saying everything that we've talked about in chapters 1 through 3, everything that we've talked about how we were dead, right? We were not under the protection of God's covenant. We were outsiders looking in, right? And because of all of that, because of God's amazing grace, it's worth it. It's worth it, right? So he's urging us, he's begging us to live a life worthy of the call. So what does it mean, this word worthy? Is it because we're worthy? So now that we've accepted Jesus, maybe now we're worthy? So now we've been made worthy? And I don't think that's it. I think it is the call that God has called us to requires more from us. And I think that because if you look at some other verses, and we're going to look at Philippians 1:27, and Paul says here, above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourself in a manner, again, worthy of the good news about Christ. Then whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I will know that you are standing together with one spirit, one purpose, fighting together for the faith, which is the good news. Again, worthy, right? So to conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel, worthy of the good news about Christ, it can't possibly mean that we're deserving of the gospel, right? Because no one is deserving of the gospel, right? No one is deserving. Because what is that? What is that gospel? That is the forgiveness of sins while we are sinners, right? So we're not deserving of it because we were sinners. We just said we were dead. We were outsiders looking in. We were not deserving of it, right? We weren't. We were separated from God when we were living that way. So it's not that we were worthy, right? So to conduct yourself in a manner worthy, it means, so the Greek word worthy means to balance the scales, right? So think about, you've seen when you weigh produce or weigh things, right? You balance the scales. So the believer who walks in a manner worthy of the calling which he has been called is one whose daily life and their daily living, it parallels. It balances the scale to his position as a child of God and an heir with Christ. That walk should show godly behavior. It should show godly character, godly morals, godly integrity, and godly behavior. To give you another example, consider some of the scandals that we've had in the presidency of the United States. Some would say that, for instance, the sex scandal with Bill Clinton, right? Or maybe Watergate with Nixon. Or maybe the Capitol takeover with Trump, right? Some have said that the position of the presidency demands better behavior than what happened in those scandals, right? The presidency, it's worthy. It demands more than those behaviors happened, right? And I want to say that this is true. We have received a calling, right? If we go back to verse 1, it says that we have received a calling. It has already came out. It was offered. It was given. And now because of this calling, we're to live a life worthy of that calling. Live a life worthy of, again, like the office of the presidency, right? So the calling upon our life should make a difference in our behaviors, should make a difference in our daily walk, how we choose to live. And I want us to go back to when I talked, when I preached 2 weeks ago in chapter 2, and it talks, and it says that once we were dead, right? You were dead because of your disobedience. You used to live in sin, just like the rest of the world. We obeyed the devil. All of us used to live that way. And by our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. And I want you to understand, go ahead and go to the next slide, sorry. And I talked about this when I got all excited, remember? And I said, but God, these amazing, amazing words. But God, so rich in mercy, he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life, right? He gave us life. So in the Bible, it says God is the one who made us alive. This is God calling us. This is the act of calling, the calling to which you have been received. And I want to kind of follow this train of thought for a second. And I want you to see, because I think when I show you this verse, now you'll understand. If you're following along, go ahead and turn to John chapter 11. And for those of you that are familiar with this is the story of Jesus calling Lazarus, right? And so then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. Remember, Lazarus had been dead for several days. He was dead. Dead men don't hear. Dead men don't move. Dead men don't respond, right? Like, something happened, right? When Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And at that instant, he was made alive. It's the call. Catch this, right? Understand this. Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out. He was obedient. The call made him become obedient. And his hands and his feet were bound in grave cloths. He was dead for several days, right? And his face was wrapped in a headcloth. Jesus told him, unwrap him and let him go. The man who was dead was now alive. Because the call of Jesus, it creates obedience in dead people. Church, we were dead. We were dead men and women walking. But then a divine act of God happened. Do you understand that? That is not from us. That is from God. This act happened because it's by his grace. Right? Ephesians 2:8 says, God saved you by his grace. And now that he's saved you, he's created us anew. We were dead, right? We were dead. But then God called us, and he's created in us something new. And this call from God, it's so powerful. It's so powerful. And again, kind of follow this train of thought with me. I hope you're still tracking with me. Now we're going to flip over to 1 Corinthians 1. 22 and 24. So, it says that it was foolish to the Jews, and they were asking for signs from heaven. And it was foolishness to the Greeks, who were seeking human wisdom. So when we were preaching that Christ was crucified, the Jews were offended, and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense. Catch this. This is important. But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. We can preach all day. I can preach all day. Y'all know I can, right? Y'all know I got a lot of words. Dave said it today. Always talking. It's true. Very true. I can preach all day. And to those of us that are not called, it may be nonsense. It's and it may even offend some people. Have you ever talked to a friend who hasn't yet been called? And they've gotten mad as you've tried to talk to them about God. They've gotten mad, right? Or you try to talk to them about God and they think you're crazy. They think you're stupid. Because they haven't had this encounter. They haven't been called. We can preach all day. You, me, everybody. We can preach all day. But until we've been called, there hasn't been that resurrection, right? They're still dead. We are now new people, right? We are created anew, we talked about. So if we're a new person, why are we going to try to continue living in our old ways, right? If we're a new person. So this is what Paul is saying. Please be worthy of the call. Understand the weight, remember, the balancing the scale, right? And it says here in verse 17, now with the Lord's authority, I say this, live no longer as the Gentiles do, for they're hopelessly confused. Their minds are full of darkness. They wander far from the life God gives because they've closed their minds and they've hardened their hearts against him. These are our friends, right? These are our friends that when we talk to and they think that we're crazy or they become offended, it's because they've hardened their hearts and they've closed off their minds. They have no sense of shame. They live for lustful pleasure, maybe, right? And they eagerly practice every kind of impurity. These are dead people. But this isn't you. This isn't you, because you've been called. You have a new life, right? So this isn't what you've learned about Christ. Since you've heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from him, there's three things Paul says we need to do. There's three things. First, throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life. It is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes, and then put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. Three simple things. Now, let's take a look at this. In verse 22, it says to throw off your old sinful nature. Throw it off, right? And he gives us this analogy of clothing. I can't help it, right? Like when you say like throw it off, like I'm thinking of a cloak or, I don't know, maybe you've been exercising and you've got sweaty clothes and you want to throw those off, right? Because they're all sweaty. Or maybe you've been outside working in the yard and you're just full of dirt. And so you want to throw those off, right? Like that's the word picture I get. I can't help it. That's the analogy I get. And I think this is on purpose. I think this is on purpose because we have to remember that our behaviors, our things that we do, these are things that are seen, just like our clothing. And so I think that's why that Paul uses this analogy, because our behaviors are seen. And so Paul is telling us to throw those behaviors off. Take those off. You are not that person anymore. You have been created anew. You are God's masterpiece. You are a new person. Stop putting on the dirty, stinky clothes. Put on new clothes. Be new, right? So I think that that's kind of the analogy, and I think it's on purpose that we're to throw off our old sinful nature. Now, the second thing is that we are to renew. Oops, I'm sorry, go to the next slide. Okay, so let the Spirit renew your thoughts and your attitudes. Now, who does the renewing? The Spirit. spirit. We cannot renew ourselves. I might have a Sam's membership, right? I have a Sam's membership. And every year I have to renew that membership, right? I renew that membership every year. I have to do that, otherwise Sam's is going to cancel my membership, right? If I don't pay, they're going to cancel my membership. Like Planet Fitness, too. I have a Planet Fitness membership. Every year I have to renew, and if I don't, it doesn't, right? Like, I have to do that. That's on me. Sam's isn't just going to renew my membership for me automatically. Well, unless you've, like, chosen an automatic renewal or something like that. So I guess that analogy doesn't work. But, you know, Sam's is not going to just automatically renew my membership for me. There's something I have to do. This is completely different, right? Like, this is me let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Let him, right? This is so important because we have to allow it to happen. We have to allow God to renew us. We can't think we've got it all figured out and we don't need him to renew us, because we don't. I'm sorry. I know sometimes we want to believe that we can do it on our own. We've got it. I was sharing with Hannah. I had a different message lined up just Thursday. I talked to Chad about my idea, and he was like, I don't think that's a good idea. It doesn't really go with what we're in this series about. And I was like, doggone it, I hate when he's right. I don't want to be wrong. And I don't want him to be right. That's for sure. Not that he gloats. But, you know, I was like, oh, man, but I want to do this. I had all these things I wanted to do. And I was like, it'll be so fun for the kids. I want to do this. Doggone it, I have to be obedient. And I don't want to do that. I wanted to do this. And Chad's just like, Amy, we're in a series on masks. That is not fitting with what the, like, do you see the disconnect? Literally on Thursday, I'm telling Hannah, I'm not ready for the bulletin because I'm rewriting my sermon today. She's like, oh, good luck with that. I'll be praying for you. So these things happen, right? Like, God speaks to us and we have to be obedient. We can't say, no, but I don't want to. I mean, we can. Sometimes I try to. I might even stomp my feet and throw a little temper tantrum. 47-year-old person throwing a temper tantrum, right? Like, no, I didn't want to do that. I wanted to do this, right? And God says, Amy, he's still working on me too. So we have to let the Holy Spirit renew us. And so in renewing this, again, the Greek word for renew, it's to grow up. So again, when I renew my Sam's membership, when I renew my Planet Fitness membership, I'm just continuing on with what I already had. I'm not moving up, right? Like, to renew that is I'm just maintaining, right? I'm just maintaining what I had before. But when I let the Holy Spirit renew my thoughts and my attitudes, I move up. I'm constantly moving up. I'm constantly growing, right? And this is not easy. This is not hard. This is hard. It really is. Like, it's simple to say this. Let the Holy Spirit renew your thoughts and your attitudes. But it's not that simple. Because it says, now that I'm going to be a new creation, I'm going to look at the world as Christ looks at the world. I'm going to look at the world through his lens, not my lens, right? Like, not what I want, but what he wants, right? I'm going to see people as Christ sees people, right? I'm not going to be judgmental. I'm not going to... my parents live in an association. And we were over there earlier this week, And it is so funny, people in associations, I'm not trying to be judgmental, but sometimes people in associations are so funny. They know everybody's business, and they will talk about everybody's business. And it's just so funny. Maddie and I were sitting over there, and Maddie was like, I didn't know it was tea time. Let me go get my coffee. Let me partake in the tea, right? Because everybody's gossiping about everybody. She didn't. I'm just being funny, right? But, like, it's so easy to get drawn into that, isn't it? Like, it's so, we have to be like, okay, I am not going to see that, right? Like, that might be how you see it, but I understand that this person is created. He knit us together inside of our mother's wombs, right? Like, that person was created. I'm not going to talk about anybody. I'm not going to bash anybody. I'm not going to do those things. This is acting in our calling, right? We're to be set apart. We're to be different. So when everybody wants to get together at the association, at the pool, and gossip and have tea time, gossip about everybody, we're to be different. We're to be set apart, right? We have to capture those thoughts. We have to capture those things that are happening and flee from it, not partake in it. We're called to be different. Again, we have a calling. God spoke into our lives something different. That is to, we're supposed to be different. And we have, and again, this is not something that we do, but we do have to allow, we have to let the Holy Spirit renew our thoughts and our attitudes. And so we recognize the lies that the enemy has, and we replace those lies with the truth of God's word. And now, after we've allowed the Holy Spirit to renew our thoughts and our attitudes, now we're going to throw off our sinful nature. We're going to put on, right? And again, it's like a garment, right? We're going to put on our new nature. That is, and we're created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. So we have to remember, we were once dead. However, God's called us and he's given us a new life. He made us new. We are God's masterpiece. We were created and crafted. So we need to shed our old life that was filled with lies, stealing, laziness, filthy language, unwholesome talk, bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, and now put on our new nature that was created by God, and only God creates, right? Go back to Genesis. Again, God spoke into creation. Only God creates. Again, the speaking, the calling. Think of how powerful God is, right? It is powerful. It's not wimpy power. It's amazing power. And now he's created us a new person. And now we're going to put that on. And now this new life is going to be characterized by telling the truth and having wholesome conversations that encourages and builds up people, right? We're not going to participate in the tea, right? We're not going to participate in the gossip, right? Because that's not building anybody up. That's just dragging people down. Understand that. We're not going to partake in that. And we're going to build others up. We're going to show kindness, compassion, forgiveness. And verse 2 of chapter 4, it reiterates this. And it says, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourself united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. So as, again, this worthy walk, it includes being humble, gentle, patient, kind, enduring love, and pursuing unity. All God asks us to do is to live lives that are consistent with who he is and what he has done for us and what he has given us in Jesus Christ. Paul wants us to know that being a Christian, it's not just merely a way of believing, but it's a way of living. Again, our actions should be congruent with our call that God has called us and created us a new creation. So because as a result of everything Christ has done, we must not live in self-centeredness. We must not live with harshness. We are to walk in gentleness. We must not try to just push our own agendas, but walk in patience and be humble and gentle. We're called to live lives that reflect the changes that God is making in us as he saved us. We're called to be different, church. We're called to be holy as Christ is holy. And so Paul's challenge to the church, his challenge to us, is that we live our lives as an example because of everything that we've been given in Christ Jesus, so that the world might see the evidence of God's saving grace and faith in his word. And the beautiful thing is, here's like the capstone of it all, is we don't do it by ourselves. 2 Thessalonians 1:11-12 says, "So we keep on praying for you, asking our God to enable you to live a life worthy of this call. May he give you the power to accomplish all the good things your faith prompts you to. Then the name of our Lord Jesus will be honored because of the way you live, and you will be honored along with him. This is all made possible because of the grace of our God and Lord Jesus Christ." May God enable you. And God's going to enable you to live a life worthy of this call. We have to allow him, though. Church, don't harden your heart. Don't harden your thoughts. Take those thoughts captive as they come in if they don't obey the word of the Lord. Right? Like we don't want to be full of deceit, right? The devil loves to make us deceive. Think back to Genesis. Think back to creation. If Eve would have taken all of the things that the serpent was saying to her, and if she would have said, "That's not what Jesus said," or "That's not what God said," right? That's not what God said, because the serpent's like, "Oh, this is this, right?" And so the deceit of that, right? She believed that. Don't believe the lies. If she would have said, "That's not what God said," and grabbed that thought, just captured it as scripture says, she would not have sinned and things would have been different. But she let the deceit, right? She did. She let deceit overtake her, and she let those seeds of doubt be planted in her mind. Church, don't let that happen, right? You have been called. You have been called. Now let's live a life worthy of that calling. Let's take off our masks and be seen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your word. We thank you for your truth. Lord, let our hearts not be hardened. Lord, let our hearts and our minds be conformed by you. Continue to conform us every single day, Lord. May we throw off our old lives, Lord. Help us renew our our thoughts and our attitudes, Lord. We can't renew ourselves. We have to be renewed. Help us put on our new nature so that we can be righteous and holy. Let your grace flow to us, and then let that grace flow out from us into a harsh and forgiving world so that your name, Lord, your name will be honored. Help us to do that today and every day, we pray. Amen.
If you would stand with us, we're going to sing a song and we're going to close our service this morning. Sometimes on this journey I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. Cause failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does.
Failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Prodigals come home. The helpless find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
The prison doors fling wide and the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. And miracles take place and the cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. The Jericho walls are quaking and strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Remember, God loves you. We love you. Go in peace.